This is Roll for Sanity.
So you guys mentioned RPG Elite. He was on the Max's thing?
Yes, yes. For 6 hours.
Was that the guy that Max was trying to get on last week? Do you know?
Yeah. He's been trying to get him on for a while. You know, okay. Like I've been watching him. You did a video on him a little while ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, Rick saw a video, so we both watched it together. It was really cool. That was a good video.
Yeah,
a lot of times he wants you to watch the part two or the part three before he gets to the good stuff. But mm-hmm. this time we were on part two, and he got to some good stuff.
Yeah, I really like him because he's an upbeat guy, you know, very, very happy-go-lucky, you know, solid, you know, life, etc. You know, I believe he's a
positive. He's positive, and he's that way because he does not. With it, misery invites company. He's the opposite.
Misery loves company. Yeah.
He doesn't want drama in his life, and he's very picky about who he associates with.
He's
paper that hasn't been wrinkled yet, basically.
Right. Well, he is a pastor, and he's a lot like GM Fritz in that respect. You know, keeping it to the game, etc. He's mostly a sci-fi superhero guy and very exuberant, which I appreciate. You know, Max is more mellow and laid back, you know, and you know, different styles, but the same goal. And I really like that because, you know, I live in California. You do too, Shauner. You know what it's like when you go outside.
So how long are your one-shots going to be?
They're supposed to be like 4 hours. So I thought it's a perfect opportunity to try to, you know, experiment with your style of role playing, you know, let the people know before we play.
Yeah, that reminds me. Yeah, I sent Elite Art RPG. What's his name? What's his real name?
Servant of Shadow.
I sent him a copy of the book after doing the thing with me and Rick. We were watching his video. I thought, you know, I should probably send him a copy. Because me and him, like, we think the same way. I don't know what happened. Like, the stars were aligned or the planets were aligned. But we grew up separately, but independently, we came up with the same way to role play, which is weird. And he doesn't like certain things I do. He plays Gamma World. I don't know how that's possible, but he does. I'm sure he would rather role play something else, our style, because I don't think you can do that with Gamma World.
Well, like we were talking about it in the email earlier today, a big part of the gaming world right now hinges on the fact that it's going to be a continual thing. And that's a big draw for everybody I've talked to lately is, you know, the campaign style. When you're done, you've got stuff. You maybe picked up treasure or new equipment. You're preparing for the next thing that's going to happen in the next episode, so to speak. Whereas from what I get from your style, it's like those things don't matter because, you know, you're just trying to, you know, make it from point A to point B to, you know, do the things and hopefully not die, even though, you know, I kind of get the impression that happens
Well, yeah, see, my book's only half finished. So a lot of the stuff you asked me in the email, I haven't even written down yet. That's in chapter 8 and chapter 9 and chapter 10. Mm-hmm. I'm still on chapter 6 or something.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I want to get into the nitty-gritty about what games to use. I wanted to keep the book agnostic, so... Mm-hmm.
Well, for games like Call of Cthulhu... And maybe Traveler and a few other games, that's not going to be an issue. You know, one shot, you know, that can continue kind of episodic like Star Trek, which would be another great example.
Yeah, I don't remember if I said Star Trek in one of my emails to you, but that's kind of how I see campaigns where you have mm-hmm. the same players each game session just doing something different.
Right.
Different quest of some sort.
That's still going to be very attractive, and you can keep the underlying thing. Babylon 5 would be another good example.
They're not leveling up or anything.
Right. Well, that you know, for me, I'm burnt on the whole grind and the leveling up thing. Just give me my character, or let me make up a character, traveler like style.
Flash Gordon. I was thinking of just using Flash Gordon euphemisms or innuendos. Yeah,
that may not go over very well, just because of the massive amount of people who've never heard of it. But yeah, girls, it's the same idea.
There's sex slaves and junk going on in that stuff from the 30s. People are going to groan. What happened?
Well, yeah, I'm going to have to go check that out. Oh, no, I'm kidding. I just want to check it out.
Ming had his harem of women on Mongo. Yeah,
even in the 1980s version, that was a thing. You know, Ming was an evil SOB, and those were perk of the job, I guess. But you know, for like other traditional games, you know, people are addicted to the, like I said earlier today with the Servant of Shiloh, the endorphin rush of leveling up is a big draw. When you get to that next level, everybody just like, I get another level. Well, when you take that away, a lot of people go away. But when you're doing a campaign or episodic or what have you, you still have some of that. You don't have the other part, which is the going up a level. But if your character's already cool, like a superhero game would be another good example. I know that may not be your cup of tea, but if you think of whether it be the Adam West Batman or some of the other ones, he doesn't go up a level. He's already maxed out.
Yes, yeah, Superman. Superman already he doesn't level up.
He may learn new things.
He learned about his home world and he got the powers and that's it. He chose a career to be a superhero. He could have chose a career to just be a farm boy, but he decided to learn the alien way of his home
world. He'll go to Metropolis and be a reporter and all that. But yeah, most superheroes don't really, you know, there may be some leveling up from issue one to a certain point, like Peter Parker. You know, you can see kind of a level up progression to a certain point. But then for the next 100 or 200 episodes, he may have come up with a new gadget, you know, or Iron Man.
Yeah, he'll improve his spider web fluid, or he improves his relationship with Mary Jane, who keeps wanting to go to Paris, but he has to fight the Green Goblin. He can't go with her to Paris for her modeling career.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, if players were more open to the idea, that's why Traveler's so good. You can make up your character how you want. Champions would probably be a good example also. You build your character, you create your character, whatever, and you're done when you're happy with where you are at. And then you don't worry about anything else because you're kind of done in that respect. Now you're going to go out and immerse yourself in the adventure and the experiences without worrying about grinding, getting a new level. That's done. But so many game systems utilize that endorphin rush as part of the draw to the game. It's a subconscious thing that people don't realize. You know, I noticed it with Dungeons and Dragons in the beginning. AD&D went from like first to, you know, kind of like 10th level. There was more after that. But it was really, really, really hard to do that. But then it was second edition. They went, nah, screw that. We're going to 20 because people leveling up. So let's make more leveling up a thing so that people keep getting that endorphin rush to kind of addict them. It really is no other way to put it, but there's an addictive quality of that.
And when these players, you ask them, oh, what character are you playing in D&D? And they say, I'm a level 10 fighter. They don't say their character's name. They don't say anything else. All they say is, I'm a level 10 fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that's boring as shit. That's boring as hell. You know, the characters, you know, I make interesting characters, or at least I think I do, whether they be NPCs or player characters or whatever. I want to make somebody that's interesting because of their personality, not their job. You know, think about this. Here's a perfect example. Bruce. We all know Bruce. We know Bruce really well. He's a great guy, right?
Yeah.
He's literally got a shitty job.
Right.
Okay? Nobody cares about the job. They care about Bruce. Bruce is a great guy. He's a nice guy. He's got a great, you know, like you said, voice for radio, a great personality, etc. You know, off screen, he may be a wife-beating son of a bitch, which I highly doubt. But he comes across as an interesting character. Okay? He is an interesting character. He's a neat guy. What he does for a living, we don't want to know. You know what I mean? He deals with the some of the ugliest situations you can imagine having to clean up,
yeah,
so to speak. Don't want to know. What's Bruce like? You wouldn't describe him as a plumber. You know what I mean? You describe him the way we know him, and that's the way characters should be. Yeah, so you're a fighter. Well, so what? There's like 40 trillion fighter characters out there in the cosmos. What makes you interesting? Why would I want to hang out with you?
So why do you think players are interested still in D&D? Like, what keeps them to D&D?
Well, magic items. Power. Really? Magic items, power, getting more powerful. The leveling up process, like I mentioned earlier. The acquisition of wealth and permanent things, like building a kingdom for some people. Just becoming super powerful. Or their combat prowess. Getting better and better and better. Those kinds of things that are, you know, you could apply them to a whole bunch of other people, but that still doesn't tell you much about the character. Okay, cool. You can kill anything you want, you know, with one hit with your sword because, okay, what does the character look like? Are they handsome? Are they ugly? Are they hunchback? Are they funny? Are they clever? Are they... you know, ingenuitive, you know, what are the real qualities other than these power gaming aspects that have been beaten into our heads for decades now? You want to be more powerful. You finally got this new level spell. Now you can cast, you know, 7th level spells. That's amazing power if you think about it. But you're never going to get that in real life. And if your character lost all of his power, would you still want to hang out with him? Would you still want to be his friend? Would you still risk your life for this person because, you know, they've endeared themselves to you, whether it be by deed or humor or just, you know, be there as a friend. They cheer you up when you're down. You know, what are the real qualities that we value in our own friendships? Those are the things that should be highlighted. Think about, you know, Star Wars again, you know, when Luke was bummed out because Ben died and Leia comes over not knowing that they're brother and sister, they're just complete strangers, just met for the first time. She puts that poncho over him and tries to comfort him. You know, those are the things that for me stand out in a story like that. You know, what happened? We still on?
I don't know if you can see that, but this is from 1984.
Like IBM. Zork or something?
It's Rogue.
Okay.
You got these ASCII text looking rooms, and use the arrow keys to tell your guy where to walk.
Right.
Okay. This was D&D. This is D&D on a computer.
Uh-huh.
And all you do is kill the things, get their treasure,
and move on.
Level up, go to the next level, walk around, fight the things that come at you, watch out for traps.
There is some aspect of the actual dungeon that is also a big draw. The overcoming of the maze and the little tiny bits of adventure in each room that aren't just combat, whether it be a trap or a trick or a puzzle or something like that. A lot of that still has an appeal to people who've never done it before. But, you know, after like 20 dungeons, you're kind of done. You know, it's like if you've been to Disneyland 20 times, you've seen all the rides. And I've been to Disneyland 20 times. You know, okay, do you want to go on
five or six? I would go whenever they would rebuild some section of the park.